Dr. Shami, I come seeking your wisdom.
My wisdom is this. It doesn't matter what you believe, as long as you are sincere in your belief.
Oh, you are so wise.
Yes. Now, why are you carrying a 2x4?
Oh, I'm a member of the religious woodbonkers, and we believe that if you hit a person on the side of the head with this holy 2x4, they will feel nothing but pleasure and go immediately to heaven.
You believe that?
You said believing is all that matters.
Yes, I did say that.
In fact, let me send you to heaven.
Hold on!
You're not supposed to duck.
Wait a minute. There are physical laws.
Quit ducking!
And one of those laws is that if you hit a person on the head with a 2x4, they will experience a lot of pain.
Wait, if there are physical laws to obey, then there must be spiritual laws to obey.
Now, I didn't say that.
Which means I may have to be concerned about truth. I may even have to examine if Jesus was who he claimed to be, which means reading the Bible.
Well, now, let's not get rash.
A message from Lifeline Productions. 1-800-52-FUNNY at lifelinepro.com.
Good morning, this is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that is God's Word to us in our modern English language. And be sure to stay tuned today because we have a special guest coming up in a few minutes. But let's start today with Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is He that made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Those are God's words from Psalm 100. Our musical guest today is Carolyn Ahrens.
Love of power, wanting more until the final hour. The day has come for us to be part of the ones who find a ruler in the power of love. Oh, la-di-la-di-la-di-la-di, the power of love. Thank you.
That was Carolyn Ahrens. We'll hear from her again at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to 1 John chapter 4, verses 15 through 21. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because He first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars, for those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from Him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. That's 1 John chapter 4, verses 15 through 21. Usually at this stage of the program, we have a scripture lesson, but this morning we have a very special guest. On the telephone with me is Pastor Johann Christoph Arnold, and he is a book author and a pastor. He has published books, and he sold over 300,000 books that have been translated into 19 different languages. Johann Christoph Arnold, welcome to Radio Good News.
Good morning. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about your own spiritual journey and how God got you to this point where you've been a pastor for a number of years and now you're a well-established book author?
I would love to. You know, my wife and I, we've been married now for 36 years. We've been blessed with 8 children and, believe it or not, 32 grandchildren.
Congratulations.
And I've been active as a pastor with my wife for over 30 years and come across often with people's needs such as loneliness, frustration, alienation, despair, suicide, and you name it. And that made me think, John, what can I do to give people something concrete that no matter how dark a situation might be, that there is an answer, there is hope. And that is what started me writing, that through real life stories, these enemies, you might say, loneliness, frustration, alienation, despair, come to the foreground, and people realize that there is an answer, there is hope, there's a reason that everyone is in this world, and that we see the value in human relationship. Yes, I might have a lot of needs, but if I look around at other people, I find out they have even bigger needs than mine, and then all of a sudden I say, wow, there is something I can do to help someone else out. And these stories, like in Be Not Afraid and Escape Routes, have proven invaluable to people.
Now, Johann Christoph Arnold, your background is not one of very easy growing up. You were born in Germany, and tell us a little bit about what happened from there to your coming to America.
Yes, I would love to. You see, that was in the 20s and 30s, and Hitler came to power, and as belonging to a religious group that opposes any violence and it stands really for life, we got in trouble with the Hitler state, and basically we had to flee Germany. We went to England, where we were for 5 years, and then the Second World War broke out, and we were enemy aliens. The government was extremely friendly. They let us emigrate together, and the only country that accepted us was Paraguay, South America, where I grew up for the first 14 years of my life. And then I came to America in 1955 and have lived here in upstate New York ever since.
Now, most of your books are published by Plough Publishing, and
correction, by Plough, P-L-O-U-G-H, Publishing House.
And that's at www.plough.com or 1-800-521-8011. And you have a number of books, but today I wanted to talk basically about Escape Routes and Be Not Afraid. I believe those are your latest books?
Correct, John.
Tell us a little bit about Escape Routes. Why did you write that, and what is it all about?
Well, I'm trying here through real-life stories, as I mentioned before, to make people realize that loneliness, frustration, alienation, and despair can be uprooted from our life and turned from a negative into a positive. You know, the choice we all have to be either selfish or selfless, to forgive instead of to hate, instead of burning with lust, to burn with love, and instead of defending your personal power, to dismantle it. And, you know, John, it's amazing the response to these stories, because people are really looking for answers. People are hurting, you know, and Be Not Afraid, Overcoming the Fear of Death, got me going because of September the 11th, because who hasn't felt the fear of accidents or acts of terror, illness or dying or loneliness or grief? And to tell people that even if a beloved one dies, it is not the end of the world, because God is still in control. And really, dying, John, is a message to the living. The more active we live, the easier it is to die. And that's the message I'm trying to give to my readers.
Well, Christoph, share a couple of the stories that we'll find in your books. I was fascinated by the account of Wolfgang Dirks.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, Wolfgang, I mean, it's in a way, it's an incredible story which points to the loneliness that people live in. He died in Germany while watching television. You know, neighbors in Berlin hardly noticed his absence. You know, he lived in an apartment house. His rents continued to be paid automatically out of his bank account. But something like 5 years later, his money ran out, and the landlord entered Dirk's apartment to inquire. And he found Dirk's remains still in front of the tube. There was a TV guide on his lap, and it was open up to December the 3rd, which was the presumed day of his death. And the television lights that had burned out, and the Christmas trees lights were still twinkling away. It's a very bizarre story, but sadly a story that happens in the world. And then I have stories of, veterans like from the Persian Gulf War, who got the Gulf War syndrome, and their lives were really one of despair, illness, and suffering, and how they have found an answer. People with MS, like the story of Diane, who is a newly married mother with a little baby, and how she has found an answer in often extremely difficult situations. And actually, that through suffering, we find out the true meaning of life. When we suffer, only then do we understand other people that suffer. And John, there's a lot of suffering going on right now. If you think of Israel, the struggle between the Palestinians and Jews with, lots of people dying and family members hurting. Well, we experienced it in our own country, 9/11 here in New York and in Washington, D.C., and the Pentagon, and you name it.
And then I think we see it day to day in the individual lives of people we encounter. I think suffering is at an all-time high.
Yes, yes, it is an all-time high. Yet through suffering, one learns the true meaning of life. One learns to appreciate life, and one learns to appreciate other people that suffer. And that then, in the end, brings true community.
But doesn't the American mindset say, oh, we should eliminate all suffering and we should never suffer at all and we want to have a pain-free, perfect existence? Isn't that what we strive to have?
America loves that, and that's where the big drug companies come in, who have a drug for every physical problem to eliminate suffering, to make a lot of money in the process of it. But my stories make also people realize that materialism, money, having a good life, never brings true joy. True joy comes in respecting, loving your neighbor, be it a senior citizen, a child, a young person, you name it. We have to respect one another, and in respecting others, that is in the end the only way in which I will be respected. And actually every person longs to be respected and recognized as a human being.
Now, from my reading of your works, it seems that there's a deep spiritual component, and that your books are not just fluffy, devotional, easy reading. They're really tough, real-life stories. And you've talked about the answer. What is the answer that you try to point people to?
Well, the answer is very simple. Right now, the way it's working, I'm talking to a lot of high schoolers, upper grade school kids, 6th, 7th, 8th graders, about nonviolent conflict resolution, that even if we experience violence, the answer never is to return violence with violence, but the true answer is, in the end, only forgiveness that cannot be done in human strength, that needs to be done with the help of God. But if you forgive, and a lot of my stories are on forgiveness, it has a cosmic effect. It changes, actually, a lot of people's life. You know, Jim, people too often think that forgiveness is a weakness, when it actually is a tremendous power that transforms people's lives, that changes people's lives, and has a ripple effect. You know, like a little boy throwing a stone into a pond, it has a ripple effect. An act of forgiveness, an act of love, changes people's life. And I have experienced that again and again. It's a tremendous power.
And that seems to be a choice that we make ourselves, whether we're wanting to forgive and striving to live as Jesus tells us to live, or if we want to hold on to that bitterness and anger and frustration. Doesn't it come down to the choices we make?
Exactly. It has to be a free, willing choice. But I always tell young people, and John, they're amazingly open, that with forgiveness, everybody is a winner. No one is a loser. I have seen the lives of people destroyed, beautiful people that could not forgive. They are consumed with anger and with hatred, and they constantly have to think of their enemy, the person that inflicted harm on them, might have even killed a beloved one. They want revenge, and they go to the court system, and then basically relive everything. And it is very hazardous to your health. You know, in England, I published a book, The Lost Art of Forgiving, and the subtitle was Stories of Healing from the Cancer of Bitterness.
The Cancer of Bitterness. That's a wonderful way to put that.
See, if we don't forgive, we are destroyed from the cancer of bitterness. And, John, unforgiveness is as destructive as a cancer. It kills slowly but surely, but it does kill.
Well, Johann Christoph Arnold, your books are available through Plow Publishing at 1-800-521-8011 or www.plow.com. And there's a free Plow reader that is sent out, I think it's four times a year, outlining the different books that Plow has. Now, in your book, Be Not Afraid, Overcoming the Fear of Death, I found that to be just a fascinating book. And isn't it normal to be afraid of death? Isn't that what everybody experiences, a fear of death?
Yes, you're right. You know, we are afraid. We don't even want to talk about it. Everybody thinks about death, and they want to avoid the issue. And a lot of the fear is removed, excuse me, by helping people to verbalize their fears, you know, talking, sharing, I am afraid to die. And then they find out that actually other people are also afraid. And again, that brings community. And Be Not Afraid is full of stories that of actual people I've counseled that have faced cancer, or a beloved one was killed or abducted.
You have a whole section on losing a baby. Tell us a little bit about that, what that does to a family and how difficult that can be.
Well, my parents lost two of my sisters at a very, very early age, and it has affected them. They were married for 40 years. You know, people speak of closure, of that you have to move on, you know, when someone dies. You want to forget about it. But when a human being dies, that he leaves a hole that no one can replace. My parents were full of fun. They had a lot of good humor. But to the very end of their days, they wept for the death of their children, not at all in a morose way. It is just simply that the closeness of God, the closeness of eternity, the meaning of the lives of my two sisters, which I actually never got to know, that even if their lives were short, they were like two angels sent by God into our midst to touch the hearts of people, to change the hearts of people. And they actually are still doing mission and changing people's life. And that is the beauty of it. You know, I have in here Mark John's story that people, a tiny young fellow, only 2 or 3 years old, he died of cancer. And people are still, this is now 30 years ago, reading his story. And I moved to tears about it because it is so true. It is so universal. You know, the Mark John story is on page 53. I just the other day in town, someone stopped me and said that story of Mark John is just incredible. So it still touches people's hearts today because it is so universal.
And your book
many,
is just
many parents face similar situations, and they do not have a place to turn to. They do not have a place where they can share their story.
Yeah, and your book is filled with stories like the John Mark story, or the Mark John story, I'm sorry. And it's just filled with really moving images. I found often while I was reading your book, I had to stop and just ponder it. And my wife and I, we've been reading it out loud to each other, one chapter at a time. And it's just very thought-provoking, and it really makes you think about your own life and where, how you would respond to those kind of circumstances.
John, just yesterday in town, I met a fireman who worked on Ground Zero in Manhattan and who was reading Be Not Afraid, and he was telling me the chapter on suffering was very, very hard to read, but very good because he saw the grief of the fireman, and that now he's on the chapter of courage, and he said, courage, that is what we all need. And he said he just loves that book. He reads it again and again. So I meet people all over town who stop me and who talk because they appreciate these very universal, personal, true life stories. People love stories. People can associate with stories. And that's why in the 10 books I've written, I always seek to put in stories. And I've traveled all over the world just looking for stories in the hope to help people in need.
Well, as we're coming up to the anniversary of 9/11, tell us the story of your friend Father Mike from New York.
I would love to. Father Mike was a very personal friend of mine. And he was the priest of an NYPD officer, Steve McDonald, who was shot in the head and paralyzed and became a quadriplegic. That means he breathes from a machine. And together we traveled twice to Belfast, Northern Ireland, to preach forgiveness to Catholics and Protestants alike. And we marched along Garvicky Road. That's this road where there has been a lot of violence, especially in the marching season. And it was incredible how both Catholics and Protestants wanted to hear Steve's story, Father Michael's stories, my stories. And it was our hope to travel to Israel. Actually, we had tickets already booked for last October to speak to Muslims, to Palestinians, and to Jews in synagogues and mosques and schools and colleges.
But you never were able to go there, were you?
We were never able to go there. September 11th came, and Father Mike, who always wanted to be there where the action was, I think, one of the first corpses they pulled out of the building. Actually, very, very fitting. And that was a tremendous loss. Father Mike was at our place, held a mass here, and a lot of local Catholics came, and he was a very, very beloved brother and friend who I still miss very much.
Well, tell us what happened on that fateful day of September 11th.
Well, I think we all know really what happened. All of a sudden, these towers collapsed and the firemen came rushing in. It even says now some managed to come up to the 80th and 90th building to get people out. And Father Mike, being the chaplain of the New York City Firemen, of course, was one of the first ones to be there. And the way I understand it, he was giving the last rites to a fallen fireman when debris hit him and killed him. And the amazing thing is, his body was whole. He was carried out whole.
You've been listening to Radio Good News on AM 1140 KS.